Hey guys, hello everyone and welcome to the channel. Now I have discussed few days back on the community tab that if you guys want solutions of PhD entrance exam of Hyderabad Central University, that is HCU. So many of you said yes, you want the solution of that. So here the video is for you. In this particular video, I'm going to solve the questions asked in PhD chemistry for January 2021 session. Now you should know that HCU conducts a PhD entrance exam in two sessions. One is January session and the other one is June session. The next exam which you might have filled the form for is for the June session. Just because of the COVID situation, the exam has been delayed a little bit. So it's probably going to be held in the next month. But yeah, that's what it is. So this question paper is for your January 2021 session. All right. I'll be solving most of the questions which are there in the question paper, and except some of the organic chemistry questions, right? Let me tell you, for those first of all who are going to give this exam for the first time, there are certain things which you should know, that there are total 80 questions in the question paper. Okay, there are total 80 questions. All questions will be multiple choice questions, MCQs will be there, and it will contain two parts, part A and part B. In part A, okay, in your part A, you will be having 20 questions, and all these 20 questions are mandatory. Alright, all these 20 questions are mandatory. You have to do all the 20 questions over here. Next will be your part B. The part B will contain 60 questions. These 60 questions are not mandatory. Out of these 60 questions, you have to just do 20 questions. You have to do any 20 questions out of these 60 questions in part B. Alright, so this is the marking scheme over here. Now each question in part A and part B carries 1.75 marks and there is no negative marking for it. As per the recent exam, as per the recent rules set by the HCU, like Hyderabad Central University. Now, you will be given OMR sheet because the exam is done offline, okay, it's not CBT mode up till yet. So, the exam is done in an offline manner. You will be given OMR sheet, you have to solve over there. Remember that calculators are allowed, okay. So, remember that calculators are allowed in the exam, so you can take your calculator along with you. Cell phones are not allowed. So that's what it is, right? Remember that the questions are not asked from general aptitude. There is no general aptitude part. So no GA part, okay? That is no general aptitude part over here. Research methodology is also not asked that directly. You will not be asked questions from research methodology that directly. Otherwise, you will have one or two questions that will be from the analytical chemistry as such. Okay? So I'll show you and you will yourself see that what type of questions are asked. All right, now without wasting any time, let's continue with the question. All right, so let's start from part A questions. The first one here, it says that the crystal system with the lowest symmetry among the following is. So when it is said about the lowest symmetry, you have to look upon the crystal system in which the angles and the bond lengths are actually not at all equal. If the things will be equal to each other, they will be the reason for the symmetry. So since you require lowest symmetry, so for that you need least symmetrical system, that is your triclinic. You all know that, because here the edge lengths A, B and C, they all are unequal to each other, and the angles alpha, beta and gamma, they are also unequal to each other. So this is the system which is least symmetrical. In case the question would have been asked for most symmetrical, then the answer would have been cubic. All right, so this is the case over here. The next question says that with increase in temperature, the electrical conductivity of the metal and semiconductor, what happens over here? So the answer is option number A. See what happens, with the increase in temperature, the electrical conductivity of metal decreases. Why it decreases? The reason is that you know that metal, the system, how we study the electrical conductivity of metal is through the C and the Kernel system, right? In which we assume that there is an electron C and the positive ions are there as the kernels, all right? They are present as the kernels and the electrons are flowing like that. So that's the system which we have studied. When you increase the temperature, so the electrons will move faster, and along with that, these positive ions will also start moving. And due to the motion of these positive ions, what is going to happen, that they are going to obstruct the movement of these electrons, and if the movement of electrons get obstructed, conductivity will get obstructed, and that's what will decrease. With the increase in temperature, your electrical conductivity of metal decreases. What about semiconductors? So the semiconductors will show higher conductivity with increase in temperature because more number of electrons will jump from valence band to the conduction band. So that's the reason why the there is an increase in conductivity of your semiconductor but decrease in the conductivity of metal. So option A is correct. All right, let's go to the next question. It says excitation that give rise to the electroluminance created by. So how this is created? The thing is that electrical field basically cause your excitation, okay, and that can luminance, that can cause luminance in nature. So electrical field, or you can say that it's an application of an electrical field. So electroluminance means luminance caused by the electric field, and that is application of electric field. The next question is from solid state chemistry. It says that X-ray diffraction peaks of a specific Miller plane of a crystal appear at the angle theta 1 and theta 2 for incident X-ray wavelength lambda 1 and lambda 2 respectively. If lambda 2 is equal to 2 times of lambda 1, they are asking that what's the relationship between theta 1 and theta 2. So it's pretty simple. You have to use the Bragg's equation to do that. So for your theta 1, the related equation with the theta 1 will be like 2d sine theta 1 will be n lambda 1, and you have 2d sin theta 2 is equals to n lambda 2. Now if the value of n is considered to be 1, so you can just purely ignore this n, okay, because of the first order reflection pattern, you can say. So this is lambda 1 and this is lambda 2. The relationship between lambda is given like lambda 2 is 2 times of lambda 1. Substitute the values, so it's like 2d sin theta 2 is equals to 2 times of 2d sin theta 1. Now why I'm not changing the value of d? Because the Miller planes are same, okay, the specific Miller plane is there. So d depends upon the Miller plane and the edge length, both are not changed, so d will remain as it is. So 2d and 2d will be cancelled out, so you'll get sin theta 2 is equals to 2 times of sin theta 1. That's your option number C. That is the correct option. Let's go for the next question. It says that critical temperature and pressure of a van der Waals gas are minus 122 degrees Celsius, that will be around 151 Kelvin, and pressure, critical pressure is given to you as 48 atm. They are asking the radius of the gas. So for this we will use a relationship between volume, critical temperature and critical pressure. So the relationship is like critical volume is equals to 3 times of R and critical temperature divided by 8 times of critical pressure. That's the relationship. Now critical temperature, critical pressure, both are given to you. Since the volume is in atm, so you can substitute the value of R in atm, that will be like 0.0821, that will be the value of R. Substitute it, solve it, calculate the value of volume. Now once you have calculated the volume, because the atom is considered to be sphere, so volume will be taken as 4 by 3 pi R cube, and that will be equal to whatever value you are going to get. Substitute it, solve it for R, so that is going to give you the answer, okay. So on solving everything, you are going to get option number B. I'm not going to do the numerical part. I have just given you formula. Substitute and try of your own. Then only you will learn how the things are being done. All right. The next question says that the ligand which forms sigma, pi, delta and phi, all types of bonds with the actinides. You know, with actinides, your like C8H8-minus complex. Sorry, this particular ion, this form metallocenes over there, like uranocene you have seen. And that particular uranocene forms sigma bond also, pi bond also, delta bond also, and phi bond also. So option number B is actually correct for this particular question. Okay, let's go to the next question. Here it says that the space and spin part of the valence bond wave function of H2 molecule in its ground state is. The question is from your Slattery's determinant, and the correct option will be option number A. Basically, the space part is symmetrical and the spin part is anti-symmetric. Okay, you, if you have solved for the hydrogen atom problem in using the Slattery's determinant, you know how this has to be done. Okay, so I'm not going to do that. I hope you have already you know that. If you don't know, I'll give you the link for this, so you can watch it in the I button. The link for Slattery's determinant video I'll give you. You can watch and understand this concept over there. All right, let's go to the next question. It says that at a constant current of 0.8 ampere is used for 15.2 minutes to deposit copper whose weight is given to you as 63.55 at cathode from an electrolyte containing copper plus 2 in water and oxygen evolution at the anode of the electrolytic cell, the amount of oxygen and copper deposited at the anode and cathode respectively. So remember that whatever in the option is given, first is the answer for oxygen and second is the answer for copper, because they are written in that order. So we can simply find out that how much copper is deposited using your Faraday's equation. So you know that Q is equals to IT, I is the current in ampere, T is the time in seconds. So using that, if you put I is given 0.8 ampere, time was 15.2 minutes, convert this into seconds and you will get 729.6 coulomb, okay, that will be the charge. So that's the value of Q here. Now using your Faraday's law, the N, that means the amount or the number of moles of a particular substance which is deposited on the particular electrode, we are talking about copper over here. So N is equals to Q upon ZF, that's the formula. N is the number of moles, remember that. So put the values here, so that is 729.6 divided by Z is, for copper Z will be 2 because the charge is 2 here. F is 96500, solve it, and N is going to be, the value of N which you are going to get is going to be 0.00378, that's the value of N. Now once you got your N, you can calculate actually the weight. So you know that number of moles is equals to given weight upon molecular mass. Substitute the value, so given weight upon molecular mass, or you can say that given weight which you have to actually calculate will be N into molecular mass. Substitute it, so N is 0.00378, multiply it with the molecular mass 63.55, and the answer you will get is 0.2403, okay, that's this value. So you have got that and your answer will be D. You don't have to solve for oxygen. If you want, you can do it in the same way for oxygen also, but since that is not needed, so that's your answer, option number D. Let's go to the question number 9 here. Effective magnetic moment of F10 ion. Okay, now for F10, for any molecule or any atom belonging to inner transition series or F block element, the formula to calculate magnetic moment is given by mu is equals to, it's like G under root J and J plus 1, right? Where J is spin orbital coupling constant, G is your Landis G factor, and G is calculated as 1 plus S S plus 1 minus L L plus 1 and plus J J plus 1, and whole thing will be divided by 2 J J plus 1. You can put all the values here. For F10, the value of L, okay, the value of L is going to be because that's F, right? So you can just fill these 10 electrons over here and then you can calculate in the F orbital, fill the 10 electrons and then calculate the value of L. So let me just do that for you. 1, 2, 3, right? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. This is how they will be filled. Now calculate the value of L, calculate the value of your S, calculate the value of J, substitute it and solve. I have done that already in my rough. So I have got my answer as option number A. You will get that. That's pretty simple. Next question is even more simple. It says number of lines shown by VO acetyl acetonate whole twice. So the structure for this you should know is something like this. Alright. So you have something like this. Now this particular compound, and you have to find out the number of EPR spectrum. The formula is 2Ni plus 1. And you know that 2 for vanadium, the value will be 1, I value of vanadium is 7/2, and plus 1, if you solve this, you are going to get 8, that's your answer, option number C, pretty simple. The next question is from your NMR spectroscopy. It says that the chemical shift in ppm of a proton that resonates at 130 Hz downfield from the TMS in a spectrophotometer operating at 60 megahertz is. So the formula to calculate it, I'm just writing here. So delta is equals to shift in hertz from TMS, okay, divided by your spectrometer frequency. So if you put the value here, it is simply 130 divided by 60, and that is going to give you a value of 2.16. All right, so that's going to be the answer of the chemical shift. Pretty simple, pretty straightforward question. Okay, the next question, which says that the origin of yellow color of CoEn whole thrice Cl3. Now here in this particular type of molecule, you know that there is cobalt is in +3 oxidation state, so there is no possibility of metal to ligand charge transfer. There is no possibility of ligand to metal charge transfer because ligand is not a pi donor over here. So in that case, there is no possibility of ligand to metal charge transfer, metal to metal charge transfer. Ligand to ligand charge transfer is also not going to happen because you don't have a pi donor and a pi acceptor ligand in the same complex. So this is also not possible. The only possibility for the color is your ligand field transition. This is nothing but your DD transition. Okay, DD transition is called as your ligand field transition. I hope this is clear to you. Next question is from Bio and Organic Chemistry. It says in the ferredoxin is a FES protein. You know that there are cubane kind of ferredoxin and there are different types of ferredoxins, right? Where the oxidation state of iron varies from. So oxidation state of iron varies between 2 and 3. You know the stable oxidation state of iron is 2 and 3. You can simply answer wherever question is asked regarding oxygen, the most possibility of the answer would be 2 and 3 only, because oxygen stays in these two stable oxidation states. Alright, the next question is on your natural product. It says that identify the set of terpenes which contains mono, di and tri terpenes respectively. The answer is pretty simple. For mono terpene, camphor, you know that, right? And for di, your answer is retinol. For this should be like tetraterpenes basically, because two retinol combined to give you a beta carotene. So the answer actually is option number C, that is your camphor, retinol and beta carotene. That should be the correct answer for this. All right, let's go to the next question. It says that the product obtained in the following biotransformation. It's a bioreaction which is catalyzed by lipase enzyme. And in this type of reaction, what happens? These are nothing but hydrolysis of, this is what? This is hydrolysis of water-soluble esters. That is what it is happening here. And in this type of reaction, it's basically stereo-specific reaction. Stereochemistry is going to be very important in the product. So if you are taking a racemic mixture, the hydrolyzed product is going to have the same stereochemistry at both the places. So it is going to give you a R enantiomer. Okay, so R enantiomer as the hydrolyzed product is going to get, and the unhydrolyzed part will be SS enantiomer. So that is what will be the product, right? Okay, next the question is from your general organic chemistry. It says identify the compound which exhibit the chirality from exhibit axial chirality. Now you know that the first option is actually having axial chirality, and these like allene type of complexes also have axial chirality. Option number 4 does not have any axis of rotation, it does not have an axial chirality. Same goes for your option number 2, because this hydrogen, the substitution on these, or you can say these hydrogens basically, they are present on the same side. Okay, they are backside of the of you. The front side you don't have a double bond, so if you rotate it through axis, the double bond will come to the front side and the single bond will go to the back side. So that's not a proper rotation through axis, or there is no axis of rotation present over here. So yeah, that's why this is not the correct option. So 1 and 3 is given in option number B. That makes the correct option for this particular question. All right, the next thing is about your identify the most appropriate method for N-terminal sequencing of peptide. This is from your biochemistry, and the answer is pretty simple. Option number B is correct. Ad-band degradation is the method which is used for your N-terminal sequencing of protein. I will request you to read about it if you don't know about it, right? So if you don't know about this ad-band degradation, read about it on Google. You will get to know more information about it. Next question is from again from your natural product. It says identify the set of alkaloids. Now there are this mescaline. Okay, so mescaline is a alkaloid. This is called as protoalkaloid. Okay, this is an example of protoalkaloid, and then vinblastine, this is basically example of vinca alkaloid. Alright, option number D is correct. Rest of them does not have alkaloid in the pair. Okay, the next question is from your IR spectrometer. So it says that the IR spectrum of an unknown compound shows very strong broad peak in the range of 2500 to 3400 centimeter inverse and a strong broad peak in 1710 centimeter inverse. So they are asking that the electron impact the mass spectrum of the compound in given below. So this is the mass spectrum of the compound given to you. Okay, so mass spectrum is given. You can see that the most stable mass fragment is of 43 molecular mass and the molecular ion is of 88. So the overall molecular mass should be 88. Now IR is going to tell you about the functional group over here. You should know that whenever you get a broad peak in the range of 2500 to 3400 and a broad peak in the case in the place of 1710 centimeter, this will resemble a carbonyl peak of carboxylic acid and this will resemble the OH bond of your carboxylic acid. Okay, so overall this both the things are telling you that the compound should contain a COOH group is present over here. Now look upon the options which are given to you. All of these are your like except option C and option D. In all of them, like in A and B, you have your oic acid, that means carboxylic acid as the substituent. Now you have to see that in which option you are going to have a fragment which is going to be so much stable of 43. So look upon this N-butanoic acid, N-butanoic acid. So that is going to be right. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and this is 2-methylpropanoic acid. So that goes like 2-methyl and propanoic acid. Now, if you see in the 2-methylpropanoic acid, this particular fragment has a mass of 43, and overall mass for both of them will be 88, obviously. So this 2-methylpropanoic acid makes more sense to the answer, and that's why it is going to be the final answer. So basically, if you have this compound, right, and this is 2-methylpropanoic acid, if you do the fragmentation of that, so you are going to get a fragment which is going to be this, all right, which is going to have a mass of 43 and plus you will have COOH. That's how the fragmentation will happen, or you can call it as CO2 and the H and is going to be formed like that. Okay, so this is how the fragmentation is happening, and that's what is the answer for this question. So these were the questions from part A. These were all mandatory questions from part A. Now let's jump into part B and see the solutions of them. All right, so let's take questions from part B now. The question number 21 here says that the number of stereoisomers possible for COEN NH3 whole twice ClBr, where EN is ethylene diamine. So you can draw this complex basically. You can just draw ethylene diamine like this, and you can draw this NH3, NH3, Cl and Br. Now this is going to be a chiral molecule. You can draw one more stereoisomer of it. Enantiomer of that, right? So that's how you can just change the positions of these and keep on drawing them. You will find out that there will be 6 stereoisomers possible for this. So one will be the mirror image of it. In the second case, do one thing, that just change the position of bromine and chlorine. So in that way, bromine will be trans to this ethylene diamine and one chlorine will be trans to this NH3. That will again give you 2, that will also be chiral. So that will again give you one more isomer. So 4 is there. Then draw one more isomer in which NH3 will be, both these NH3 will be over here, bromine and chlorine will be on the axial bond. So they, that is also going to be chiral, that will also give you one more enantiomer. So overall 6 stereoisomers are going to be possible for this question. Alright. Okay. Let's see the next one. It's a numerical question. It says concentration of H plus in a solution of NaOH having pOH of 11.3 is. So you know this, that pH plus pOH gives you 14. Now pOH is already given to you, so pH will be like 14 minus pOH, that is 11.30, and this will give you something like 2.70. that's your pH. You know that pH is nothing but negative of log of H plus ion, and that is nothing but 2.70. solve it. So log of H plus ion, that will be minus 2.70 concentration of H plus ion. You have calculator, so you can take anti log of minus 2.70 and that will give you a value of 2 into 10 to the power minus 3. दैट इज वॉट यू विल गेट. बेसिकली द आंसर विल बी 0.00199 समथिंग लाइक दैट, एंड दैट विल बी क्वाइट इक्विवेलेंट टू दिस वैल्यू. सो 2 × 10⁻³ मोलर इज द आंसर, एंड दिस इज हाउ इट विल बी सॉल्व. द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन सेज दैट द मोस्ट स्टेबल द मोस्ट प्रिफर्ड कैटायन फॉर वेलिनोमाइसिन इज. ओके, सो वेलिनोमाइसिन इज नथिंग बट अ नेचुरली अकरिंग. ओके, दिस इज नेचुरली अकरिंग डोडेका पेप्टाइड, एंड दिस इज यूज टू ट्रांसपोर्ट पोटेशियम आयन. ओके, फॉर व्हाट इट इज यूज टू ट्रांसपोर्ट के प्लस आयन इन द फॉर्म ऑफ एज एन एंटीबायोटिक. दैट्स अगेन फ्रॉम योर बायो ऑर्गेनिक केमिस्ट्री. द आंसर इज गोइंग टू बी ऑप्शन नंबर बी. इट इज यूज टू ट्रांसफर पोटेशियम आयन. ओके, यू कैन रीड अबाउट इट. जस्ट सर्च फॉर वेलिनोमाइसिन ऑन गूगल. यू विल गेट टू लर्न अबाउट इट. देर इज लॉट ऑफ इन्फॉर्मेशन अबाउट इट. ओके, सो जस्ट रीड अबाउट इट. ओके, द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन सेज दैट कंपेयर टू द ग्राउंड स्टेट फोटो एक्साइटेड क्लोरोफिल एक्ट एज. सो फोटो एक्साइटेड क्लोरोफिल एक्ट एज बोथ सुपीरियर ऑक्सीडाइजिंग एजेंट एंड रिड्यूसिंग एजेंट बोथ. I'll give you an image over here. You can see that how chlorophyll is acting as oxidizing agent as well as reducing agent. So just take a screenshot of this particular image. That will help you to understand that what actually is happening. Okay. So yeah, this question is from a recent research study. You can read about it on Google again. Okay. The next question is pretty simple from your group theory. It says that the point group in this particular molecule is going to be D3. If you are practicing questions, you know this. That there is no plane possible over here, so just one C3 axis, and along with that there will be three more C2 axis perpendicular to it. So overall it is going to become a D3 plane. Okay, so that is going to have D3, and over here if you see here in this case you have a C3 axis of rotation passing through the axial fluorine phosphorus fluorine bond. Along with that you have three C2 axis passing from each phosphorus fluorine equatorial bonds, and these are all perpendicular to the principal bond principal axis. So overall it will become a D3, and there is a sigma h plane, which plane is perpendicular to the principal axis. So sigma h will get combined. The option will be D3H. So the answer is option number C. Pretty simple and pretty easy question. Okay, let's go to the next question. Sandwich type of ferrocene, the orbital involved in the bonding are. If you have studied the bonding phenomena of your ferrocene, either if you have studied it from Isler and Tarr or any standard book, you know the answer. The answer is dxy, dyz and p pi orbitals. Okay, so that is the correct answer for the sandwich type of ferrocene. The orbitals involved are these. Okay, the product of reaction of sodium with 2-2-2 krypton. This is again from your organic bioorganic question, and this is going to give you a complex of your sodium. A cationic complex of your krypton, along with that sodium anion will be present over there. Okay, so this is the reaction which it is. Okay, fine. I know some questions are pretty difficult. You might be hearing them for the first time, but it's fine. Those which are easy, focus on them, because you have to just do 20 questions in part B. Okay, here question number 29 says anhydrous aluminium chloride and gallium chloride are covalent in nature but form metal ion in solution because. Why do they do that? So in solution they are covalent in nature, but in their solution they are going to behave as the ions, metal ions. So the reason is this, that the ion are hydrated in the solution, they will be hydrated, and the amount of hydration energy released exceeds the ionization energy. So when the hydration of these ions happened, in that case the energy which is released is more than the ionization energy. So during hydration actually ionization of aluminium and gallium is also happening, and that's why it basically forms metal ions, right? So yeah, in the solution case or in the solution phase they behave as a metal ion. In the normal or without in the solution, or if they are not present in the aqueous solution, they basically are anhydrous form of them are covalent in nature. Okay, correct statement from the following. You have to tell what are the correct statement. First says cobalt in +3 aqueous is a powerful oxidizing agent. That's true. Okay, second statement says that CONH3O6 is a less labile than CONH3O6 3+. Now you know here this CONH3O6 3+ दिस इज अ डी सिक्स स्पीशीज एंड दैट टू लो स्पिन. सो दिस इज बेसिकली इनर्ट, राइट. एंड दिस पर्टिकुलर वन इज गोइंग टू बी डी सेवन एंड दिस इज गोइंग टू बी हाई स्पिन. सो दिस इज गोइंग टू बी लेबाइल, राइट. सो यू नो दैट दिस इज मोर लेबाइल देन दिस. सो ऑप्शन नंबर टू इज नॉट एट ऑल करेक्ट. सो कैंसिल आउट दोज विच हैव ऑप्शन नंबर टू. सो ए एंड सी आर कैंसिल. लेट्स लुक अपॉन द लास्ट वन. इट सेज ओवरऑल फॉर्मेशन कॉन्स्टेंट ऑफ सी यू एन एस थ्री प्लस थ्री इज मच हायर देन दैट ऑफ सी यू एन एस थ्री सिक्स प्लस टू. बेसिकली फॉर्मेशन कॉन्स्टेंट मीन्स दे आर टॉकिंग अबाउट सी एफ एस सी. कैलकुलेट सी एफ एस सी एंड यू विल सी दैट इट इज एक्चुअली करेक्ट. सो स्टेटमेंट वन एंड थ्री बोथ आर करेक्ट. ऑप्शन नंबर बी इज द करेक्ट ऑप्शन फॉर दिस क्वेश्चन. द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज एक्चुअली रिपीटेड फ्रॉम सी एस आर नेट एग्जाम. रिएक्शन ऑफ एक्स सी एफ टू एंड ए एस एफ फाइव. एक्स सी एफ टू बिहेव एज अ फ्लोराइड डोनर. ASF5 behave as a very good fluoride acceptor. Option number A is correct. They are going to form a complex. All right. This is repeated from, I guess, CSIR 2016 or 17. Just check it out once. All right. The next question says that the correct statement regarding the substitution reaction of octahedral complexes via associative pathway. So, see what happens. Let's say if I have a complex, okay, platinum complex having X as the ligand. Associative mechanism I am showing you. So if Y ligand comes in, so first of all it is going to form a transition state in which Y will be here, like coming over here, and in the next step X will get removed. So here Y is coming and here X is getting removed. So now you will have a complex with Y present, X, X and X. Now what they have asked is for the activated complex. This is your activated complex. So look upon here, what is happening? See, two things are combining to give you a single thing. So your delta S will be negative, right? So large negative value of delta S, that is correct. And also earlier the volume is bigger, now they have combined, so the volume is going to decrease. So final volume is smaller, initial volume is bigger, because two things will be obviously having bigger volume than single thing. So a large negative value of delta V hash means for the activated complex. So both these statements are actually correct, first and fourth. So option number C is the correct option for this, right? Okay, let's look upon the next question. Here it says product of the following reaction. See, when you have this type of question, one easy way is to look upon the oxidation state of the reactant and product. They generally does not change whenever the substitution reaction happens between the ligands. So lanthanum over here is in plus 3 oxidation state, iron is in plus 2 oxidation state. Look upon the option where they are same. So here again you can see iron is in plus 2, lanthanum in plus 3. In all the other options, iron is in plus 3, here also it is in plus 3, so that cannot be possible. Oxidation state does not changes. Here it is in plus 2 and plus 2, again that has changed, so now it is not possible. Here although that is fine that it is plus 2 and it is plus 3, but here it's a partial substitution which has happened, that is not going to happen. So option D also is incorrect. Option C is the correct option for this particular question. All right, let's look upon question number 34. It says incorrect statement regarding berylocene. Berylocene is, you should know what berylocene looks like. So a berylocene is having structure, beryllium should be here, and then here you have a eta 1 molecule. So you have eta 1 CP and eta 5 CP. So that's first one is wrong, that it's coordinated to 2 eta 5 CP. No, distance between beryllium and 2 CP ring is not equal. So this is a true statement. All right, next is it has a slipped sandwich structure RES. It looks like the sandwich has just slipped up. So yes, that is also correct. It does not obey 18 electron rule, that is also correct. So they have asked incorrect statement, right? So the incorrect statement is A only, that's the incorrect statement. Okay, the next one is from your completing the reaction. The first step you can understand that Fe3O4, there is a reduction happening, so you need a carbon monoxide to do this reduction. Oxygen cannot allow to do reduction, right? So obviously A was having two options, O2 and CO. So CO will be the option. So you can cancel out option A and option D. In the next step, FeO is basically going to again reduce to Fe. So again you need a reducing agent. So B has also to be CO. In both the options we have COCO, so that is fine. Okay. Then the C is getting formed. In this C, you can see that Fe is reacting with carbon monoxide. So when it will react to carbon monoxide, it is going to form a stable metal carbonyl. So stable metal carbonyl of iron is your FeCO5. So C is your basically FeCO5. Okay, that is coming in option number B. And the last one also you can see that FeCO5, if you react it with KOH, this is going to give you a salt or a coordination compound, right? So this is how this question has to be done. Let's look upon the next one from bio and organic chemistry. It says that the oxidation state of hemoglobin, myoglobin, transferritin and ferritin. They have not asked about the oxidized state or the the deoxyhemoglobin or oxyhemoglobin. They have not said. They have just said hemoglobin. You have to take the deoxy form. So the correct option for this will be option number D. For hemoglobin it's +2, myoglobin +2, transferritin it's +3, ferritin is also +3. So that is the correct option for here. All right, let's look upon the next one. It says that the number of electrons donated by an alkyne ligand bridging to two metal centers. So an alkyne means alkyne, right? C triple bond C bridged to two metal centers. This is going to give you four electrons. It's a four electron donor, two electrons from each pi bond. That's how it donates. The structure of N2B4H6, pretty simple. Remove this N and replace this N with BH2 unit, right? So you will get BH2 whole twice, B4H6. You will have B6H10, which gives you Nido structure, right? Simple and easy question. Okay, let's go to the next one. It says that the type of IR spectrum is not shown by, which of them is not going to show it? You have to understand that your bridging carbonyl, okay, your bridging carbonyl, which is bridged to two metal surface, this gives you peak between 1870 to 1830 centimeter inverse. That's the range for it. So that means whatever the molecule is there, they are asking that which is not going to show this. So it should not have, here we have that peak, right? This peak, it's around 1870 something over here. So that means this particular peak is going to be not possible for that molecule which does not have a bridging carbonyl. And if you have studied the structure of all of them have bridging carbonyl except iridium complex. IR4CO12 does not have a bridging carbonyl. Its structure is pretty simple. IR, IR, and IR, and all of these attached with your carbonyls. Okay, so that's how you will have CO12. Alright, this is how it has to be done. Let's see the next one. Alright, let's talk about this question number 40. It says that the complex ion expected to exhibit both spin orbital magnetic moment. So for a spin orbital magnetic moment, the condition is that your T2g orbital should be asymmetrically filled, right? So for the first case, you have a Ti plus 3, it's a D1 complex, but it is a tetrahedral complex. So here your E is going to be asymmetrically filled. The next one is your chromium in plus 3, and that too it is going to be low spin complex because of the H2O ligand. And you know this, right? If you have followed my classes, you know that water is going to behave as a strong field ligand with chromium plus 3. So it's a D6 species, symmetrical filling, no possibility of spin orbital coupling. Iron over here is going to have Fe in plus 2, and again it's a D6 species, low spin because of CN ligand, again no possibilities of spin orbital coupling. The next one is your D9 system, and this is tetrahedral, so if you fill it, this is going to be like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6, 7, 8 and 9. Now if you see this T2 energy level is asymmetrically filled, it is going to show spin orbital coupling. So that's why option number D is correct. Simple and easy one. Okay, if you have followed my classes, if you have studied from my YouTube videos also, most of the questions you can do, especially from coordination, organometallic, you can easily do them because I have taught all these things in my class. Okay, it says that the difference in the potential between the fixed part and the double layer of the bulk solution is. It's pretty simple. It's the definition of zeta potential, right? You know, when the double layer is formed, there is a fixed layer that is called your Stern layer, and then you have the moving layer or the bulk solution. The difference in the potential between both of them is called as your zeta potential. All right, let's look upon the next question. The next question over here, it says at constant pressure, the heat capacity of 1 mole perfect gas varies with the temperature. This is the formula given to you. The change in internal energy when the temperature is raised from 0 to 100 degree Celsius, that means from 273 to 373 Kelvin. All right, so in order to solve this question, you need to have a relation. You have du is equals to Cv dt, and Cv is equals to Cp, because the value is given for Cp. So Cp minus R dt, or you can say that du is equals to Cp dt minus R dt. If I integrate it, I have to put the values first of all. So Cp value is already given to you, that is 20.17 dt plus 0.4 T dt and minus R dt. And now you have to integrate it. Everything has to be integrated. That is how you will get your internal energy. Limits I will put later on. The limit is from 273 to 373. So here 20.17 will remain as it is. Dt will get integrated to give you T from 273 to 373. Plus 0.4, this will be t square by 2, limit is again from 273 to 373 minus r, and again this dt will be like t from 273 to 373. Put the values of everything here, so this is like 20.17 multiplied by, if you put upper limit minus lower limit, you will get 100, plus this you can cancel out, this will be 0.2, and here you have to do 373 square minus 273 square. You have to use calculator here to solve it. Minus R value you have to put as the given in the question, 8.314 into again 100. Solve this and you are going to get 14105.6 joules, or you can say 14.1 kilojoules. So option number D is correct. This is how this question has to be done. Pretty simple and straightforward question. Okay, let's look upon the next question. This is from your thermodynamics. It says del S by del V at constant T is how much? Pretty simple. There you have to answer in terms of alpha and KT. If you know the values of alpha, alpha is given by 1 upon V del V by del T at constant P, and KT is nothing but isothermal compressibility, that is given by minus 1 upon V and dV by dP at constant T. And you know that ds by dv at constant T, using Maxwell relation, this will be equivalent to your dp by dt at constant V. Now substitute the values using it, put it all and solve it. I'm not going to do that, but on solving it you are going to get option number C, alpha upon kt. That's the thing which you are going to get. Okay, dp by dt at constant V, this thing has been asked many times in CSIRnet also. If you just divide these two things, basically you are going to get dp by dt at constant V. You can try it of your own. You can try to do this and you will get the same. Okay, the next one says two polymers, one having mass this much, other having mass this much, are mixed in the mole ratio as this much. The average molar mass is calculated using the formula of, like, the average molar mass is given by, let's say, m bar. This is like x1 and m1 plus x2 and m2. X1 is mole fraction of the first species, X2 is the mole fraction of the second species. So since it is 3 and 2, so you know X1 will be like 3 upon 5, because mole fraction is calculated like the mole of the first species divided by total mole. So 3 plus 2, that will be 3 upon 5. Mass of the first species is 62, and plus mole ratio of the second species will be 2 upon 5, 2 upon 2, 3 plus 2. And the mass is 78. Substitute, like cancel out, solve, you will get something around 68.4 kg per mole. Option number B is the nearest option, so that's the correct one. Okay, next question, it says that which of the following molecule among H2, HCl, CH4 and H2O can show a rotational Raman spectrum. So H2O and HCl can show rotational Raman spectrum because they possess a permanent dipole moment. So obviously they are going to do that because they satisfy the condition of rotational spectrum. whereas CH4 will not do that because that's a symmetric top molecule, spherical top molecule, that will not show a rotational spectrum. Talking about H2, so because of your polarizability caused by a diatomic H2 molecule, it is going to be Raman active. So option number D is the correct one. H2, HCl and H3, H2, all of them are going to show rotational Raman spectrum. Let's look upon the next question. The ground state term symbol for carbon atom. This is the easiest question. I hope every one of you can do. The electronic configuration of carbon is 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. Still two electrons here, plus 1, 0, L value will be 1. That means P spin multiplicity is 2 plus 1, that is 3. So 3p, option D is correct. Simple, straightforward question. It says C3 2, then C2 and then C3. So you know that when you multiply C3 2 with C3, basically it will become C3 3, that will be equal to identity, and when you multiply identity to anything, that will become the same thing. So it is like C3 2 multiplied by C3 multiplied by C2. So this will become identity, and identity multiplied by C2 will give you C2. Option number D is correct. Next one says that a function that is not well behaved. So you have to know the graph of these functions, and if you have watched my video of acceptable wave function, you might know how to solve it. You have to see the graph of it. If I show you the graph of e to the power minus x, the graph actually is drawn something like this. It is like this and then like this. Okay, so basically you have a kind of point over here. Okay, there is a kind of, you know, it's not curve, it's a junction which is peak kind of thing. So you know, whenever you get a peak kind of thing or a kind of, you know, a sharp bend in the graph over there, the graph or the function is not having a definite first order differentiation. You can try it. You can try to do the first order differentiation of this, and that will be discontinuous over x is equals to 0. That makes option number A as not well behaved wave function. All the others will be well behaved. Option A is not. Question number 50 says normalized wave function of the particle moving along x axis, and you have to tell it is given by this, the constant A is. So pretty simple way, I'll tell you how to do it. You have to basically do this psi star psi d tau, and you have to take it equal to 1. That means if I put the values, I will get A square, and in the bracket I will get e to the power minus 2 a x square dx, and this should be equal to 1. The integration of e to the power minus 2 a x square, I'll just write down that integration of e to the power minus 2 a x square is going to be under root pi upon 2a. Okay, if it is integration of e to the power minus x square, this is just under root pi. Okay, so you should know this thing, that whatever value is here, that will be going in denominator. If it is e to the power minus a x square, then pi by a, right? That's like, that's how it is. So this is going to be a square multiplied by the value of this is under root pi by 2a, and this is equals to 1, which makes a square is equals to under root 2a upon pi, which makes a is equals to 2a upon pi whole to the power 1 by 4, which makes option number D as the correct option. Simple and easy. Point group of 1,2-dichlorobenzene. Simple, 1,2-dichlorobenzene will have certainly similar structure just like water molecule. It will have a C2 axis of rotation. It will have two vertical planes. So C2V is the answer for this. The next question which says that the magnetic field at which proton would resonate at frequency of 150 megahertz is given beta n value is this much and g value is this much. Let's try to do it. Basically, the energy of a particular proton in a particular magnetic field is given as beta n, then g and b. B is the magnetic field, or b naught I can call it. That's the magnetic field we have to calculate, and this is also equal to h nu. Nu is the frequency that is given to you as 150 megahertz. Your b naught will be h nu divided by beta n g. Put the values. So b naught will be h is 6.6 into 10 to the power minus 34 multiplied by the frequency that is 150 megahertz. So 10 to the power 6 I have to write down in order to convert it into hertz. Beta is like 5.05 into 10 to the power minus 27. And g is 5.6. You have to solve, put the values, like I have already substituted the value, solve it, you will get 3.5 tesla. So that's the, that is going to be the answer for this. Okay, so 3.5 tesla is the answer for this. All right, the next question says that which is the enthalpy of, what is the enthalpy of reaction for which the equilibrium constant is doubled when the temperature is raised from 27 degrees Celsius to 37 degrees Celsius. Okay, that's the question. Simple as it is, the equation which we are going to use is ln K2 upon K1 is equals to minus delta H upon R, and here you have 1 upon T2 minus 1 upon T1. That's the logarithmic form of your Arrhenius equation, but the energy is kept in the terms of enthalpy. Okay, so this is taken from there. You can substitute the values which are given to you, T1, T2. Remember to convert everything in Kelvin. Put the values of temperature, put the values and K1 and K2 is given, right? So K2 is 2 times of K1, that's given. T1 is like 300 Kelvin and T2 is 310 Kelvin. Substitute, solve, R values given to you. You will get option number C as the correct option. Simple. Okay, the next question says, according to the transition state theory, the reaction between two molecules is slower than that between two atoms by a factor of. So it's a direct answer. Option number B is the correct option for this. The next question is pretty lengthy. You have to use the knowledge of group theory to solve it. They have given you reducible representation. They are asking irreducible representation. So you have to form lambda irreducible. If you have studied from my videos, you know how to do this. And in the lambda irreducible representation, you have to tell that what are the coefficient of A1 and A2. Okay, so what are the coefficient of A1 and A2, that's what you have to do. So try it of your own. I will suggest you to do this. It's very simple question. If you have any doubt, you can watch or refer my videos. I'll give you the link to watch them in the I button here. Okay. All right. The next question says that if the 0 point energy difference of RH and RD is 45 kilojoules per mole at 25 degrees Celsius, the kinetic isotope effect KH upon KD for the reaction is, there is a direct formula for this. So KH upon KD is equals to exponential, and you have delta E divided by KBT. Delta E is already given to you, that is 4.5 kilojoule, convert it into joules, and KB is Boltzmann constant, T is the temperature, convert it in Kelvin, so 298 Kelvin it should be. Substitute and solve, and you will get option number D as the correct option. All right. The next question says that the rate constant for the reaction is found to decrease with increase in temperature, indicating that. Okay, so what happens if the rate constant of the reaction is decreasing with the increase in temperature? It can never be exothermic, because for exothermic, on increase of temperature, rate constant will increase. Ultra fast reaction also increases with the rate when the temperature increases. Diffusion also increases, because you know, when you increase the temperature, diffusion rate will increase, so that the rate constant will also increase. The only reaction which is possible is your complex reactions. So complex reaction is the reason. The mechanism which causes inter-system crossing, remember the Jablonski diagram, inter-system crossing is done because of the spin orbit coupling. So spin orbit coupling is the reason for it. From here onwards, from question number 61 to question number 80, all these 20 questions are from organic chemistry. So try them. All these, you can see in part B, there are 60 questions. Out of them, 20 is from organic, 20 from inorganic, 20 from physical chemistry. So try organic chemistry part, that I am leaving for you guys. I am not that great at organic chemistry. I am just leaving that portion for you. I am just going to do one question, that is from your spectroscopy, right? So this is the question here, last question. It says that a compound with molecular formula of C4H12O3 with which will show the following proton NMR spectrum. Now you have to see that what you are getting in the proton NMR spectrum. Okay, here you are getting a quartet. Here you are getting a triplet, here you are getting a singlet, here you are getting a triplet. So this is the pattern which you have. Now draw or write it down in the options what you are going to get actually. Singlet, triplet, triplet, then you are going to get a quartet, right? So you are going, a quartet and a triplet. So it's basically giving you three triplet, one singlet and one quartet. So option A is a possible answer. Let's look upon option B, just on the splitting. So it is singlet, triplet, triplet, then you have a quartet and a triplet. So again, that is also a possible answer, option number B also. In option number C, if you see, again you are having a triplet, a quartet, triplet, triplet, and then you have a singlet. It's also one of the possible options. Option D cannot be the answer because here you have singlet, triplet. Okay, here you have okay, that's also going to be the possible answer because you know that is also following the same trend. Okay, so let me just so here you are going to get this is going to be a quartet and triplet. So every option is following the same multiplicity. Now what you have to see is this triplet set, okay, where it is. The triplet set is quite at the value which is not that much downfield. So if this triplet set is attached to a electronegative atom, okay, if it is attached to electronegative atom, which is in option number A and which is also in option number D. So here both, see, this particular part is attached to electronegative atom. So if it is so, then there should be more downfield. It should not be at 2.07, 2.67. There should be more downfield. Okay, there should be at more downfield value. So because they will be more deshielded because of this oxygen. So that's why option number A and option number D cannot be the correct options, right? Talking about your option number B here, this singlet one is attached to this oxygen. That means the singlet proton or the protons causing the singlet peak, they should actually give you a downfield value. That is also not happening here. They are also in a relatively upfield value, okay, compared to the others. We have to see, so compared to this quartet, okay, which is attached to this carbonyl, this singlet is upfield. So that means the electronic cloud, according to this, the electronic cloud of singlet should have been on the downfield side and electronic cloud of this quartet should be on the upfield side. That is not happening here, okay. So that's why you have to cancel out this option. Everything is getting satisfied for option number C. You can see it here. See, the quartet is relatively downfield. Why? And it's most downfield because it is directly attached to the oxygen. The triplet is not that much downfield because they are not attached to the oxygen over here or to an electronegative atom. Singlet is also relatively upfield and the triplet over here is also relatively upfield. So this option number C is actually the correct option according to the places or the signal values, relative signal values of all the protons. So that's how option number C becomes our most possible or the most appropriate answer for that particular question. All right. So I have tried to solve most of the questions from this question paper. The idea is that you guys have to solve all these question papers are available on the official website of HCU. If you are planning to give this entrance exam, practice all the previous questions. That will just give you more and more confidence. If you are not able to solve a particular question, ask them in different Facebook groups, Telegram group. There are so many discussion groups where you can ask these questions. You can ask to anyone from whom you are preparing, like under whom guidance you are preparing. If you are not taking any classes or anything to prepare, you can ask in the forums, right, in the Facebook and other places where people ask their doubts. So that's what it is. So this was all for this particular video. I tried to solve as many questions as possible. I hope you guys understood it well. If you have any doubt, you can ask in the comment sections below. That's it from my side. I will see you in the next one. Till then, have a great day. Bye bye. Hey guys, so I teach for CSI RugiCNet category on Unacademy platform. Over there, I take free classes as well as paid classes. You can reach out to my profile using the link given in the description of the video. You will find various free courses. Also, there are some paid courses. The paid courses are highly organized. They are regular and they are on the daily basis. So, in case if you are interested and you want to join my paid classes, for that, you have to take Unacademy Plus subscription. You can do that by using my referral code, that is N_Huda. That's my referral code. If you use that referral code, you will get 10% discount on the subscription. Also, you'll get access to join my WhatsApp group along with other plus. So do check out my profile and access all the free classes. Take the benefit of them. So that's it from me.